Perhaps you've often thought to yourself that nothing could be finer than to be in Elkton, Maryland on a cold and rainy Saturday in October for one of the world's most prestigious three-day events. Well, you don't have to go through all that because USEV is on the road again to do it for you.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Fairhill International 3-Star CCI from Elkton, Maryland. My name is Luann Franisich, and I'm here with Ralph Hill, member of the 3-Day Squad United States Equestrian Team.
Well, Luann, this is going to be an exciting weekend. There's over 70 international 3-day horses competing here this weekend. That's the largest field we've had in North America for quite some time. This is the last time that horses and riders will be able to qualify for the World Championships next year in Holland. So this should be quite an exciting weekend.
Okay, for the uninitiated, let's have a look at what the 3-day consists of.
3 ways over 3 days, that's how it's done in this ultimate triathlon of horsemanship. Day one is the dressage test, performed in an enclosed arena 20 by 60 meters. This particular test has 23 movements. They're scored 0 to 10 and then converted to penalty points, which you take over with you to endurance day. Day two, 4 distinct phases to this day for which a 3-day horse and rider live for. All phases have time limits, B and D have substantial jumping efforts, and D also factors in terrain and multiple jumping efforts. Penalties add up for stops, refusals, falls, seconds over the time limit. Elimination can occur for 3 stops at any one element, or fall of the horse, or 2 falls of the rider. All this then takes you into day 3, the stadium day. Returning to the enclosed arena for another test of skill over traditional standards and rails. And there are more possibilities for penalties for drop rails, stops, falls, and time over the limit. And on dressage day, David O'Connor and Wilton Fair took the lead with a 45.6.
Karen Lundy, the new Mrs. O'Connor, right behind him with a 48.2. Missy Ranshausen, 49.4. Didier Cigaret, all the way from France, on Cour de Rocker, 51.2. And Bruce Davidson with Regent Lion, 52.2.
This is one of Bruce's up-and-coming horses. He's ridden this line, this family. The main horse that he'd had, a really good horse called Pirate Lion. This horse is related to Pirate Lion. He has another one called Eagle Lion. So Bruce really likes this bloodline. They've been, you know, proven nice event horses. He's hoping this will be his next really good one. There's a nice half pass. He's being scored for the rhythm, the crossover, making sure that the shoulders are leading.
A lovely half pass there by Bruce and Regent Lion. And here we have another well-known international rider, Didier Cigaret, coming all the way from France and the other side of the big pond, bringing Cour de Rocker with him, an 11-year-old Anglo-Arab, a lovely extension there across the diagonal, and now the reinback. Didier, a very successful rider in France, bringing this horse over to qualify him for the World Championships next year, as this is the last qualifier, as unfortunately Buccalo got canceled because of excessive rains there. They just couldn't control the drainage of the course. So Didier's got to qualify this horse here, and here's what he thinks of the Fairhill course.
When we look the course for the first time, I think the course is not too difficult. But when you walk 2-3 times, I think second time is more difficult, and third time, you look, you say it's a difficult course, I think. I think it's obstacle and the ground.
Well, it looks like Cour de Rocker's getting ready to take a nap down there.
Okay, interesting comment there from Didier. That was Andy Hurd helping us out, and he is a former top international groom at the 3-day level. And he's going to be down in the vet box giving us a little insight as to what happens down there. Missy Ranshausen in Pacific Lion now.
She's putting in a really nice steady test. It's a big attractive horse. Missy's mother is a rider that is ridden on the dressage
Jessica
Ranshausen. And so
Missy could not get away with having a bad dressage round.
Exactly. So that's Missy knows what she's in there for.
And here we have Karen Lundy, or the new Mrs. David O'Connor, taking Shannon around in her dressage.
Now, here's a different look. Missy's horse was, you know, really big and soft and balanced. And here's a smaller, balanced, a little typier, thoroughbredy looking mare.
Yeah, this is an American thoroughbred, originally found and trained by Michael Godfrey.
Yes, who had a very successful, you know, time with her. Now Karen's riding, demonstrating the extended trot.
And here, the Mr. David O'Connor, taking Wilton Fair around in a really nice counter canter.
Yes, and that's a very difficult movement for a really fit horse. And this horse is, I believe, 16 or 18 years of age.
Right, 16.
16. And this is going to be his final event. He's going to retire him after this. And look, he's still got a little spunk there. You saw him come around the turn. That's just a small deduction. David contained it real well. The old man was just letting David know, hey, still pay attention.
A real elegant guy.
Yep.
And a lovely test. And, of course, he did take the lead here. A great start for the final round for this big guy, big Irish bred horse. Okay, down to Andy now, who's going to give us some of that insight into the vet box.
The 10-minute box is located at the end of C and is probably the most intense phase of the competition for the event groom. It often resembles, as you'll see tomorrow, pit row at the Indianapolis 500. However, mistakes made at this phase can be very costly and often will lead to elimination. This is the actual point where the horse will enter the vet box. This is the end of phase C. And as you see when we walk through here, today while it's very quiet, tomorrow there'll be a tremendous amount of traffic. So first of all, this is where we're going to see the horse come in. So obviously this is where the most amount of activity is going to be taking place, with vets checking the horse, people moving horses around. So I look around this vet box, and as you'll see as we walk into the vet box, you've got a large area up this line of trees where there's sufficient shade from the sun or from the wind. But you wouldn't want to be in this area because of the amount of traffic. So I'd like to walk up the vet box a little bit further and see just how far away from this traffic we can get. You obviously wouldn't want to be in this area, as this is where the horse will exit the vet box before the start of phase D. So this would be the area that I would choose to lay my equipment at. It's in fairly close proximity to the entrance and the exit, but at the same time you're not going to be right in the middle of traffic. You've also got a good view of the horses coming in and coming out. There's nice shade from the trees, and you're also in close proximity to the water. The next thing to look for in the vet box, and I think this is very important and often can cause problems on cross-country day, is to look for an area where you're going to be able to jog the horse for the veterinarians. You'll often see in the vet box people that haven't previously picked a spot trying to jog a horse on uneven ground or jogging them in too small an area. And the vets really need to see this horse moving freely, and you don't want to jeopardize the chance of the horse being spun in the box. So where I would look around here, this is a perfect area. It's a flat, fairly level piece of ground with, if anything, a slight incline as opposed to jogging down the hill. You never want to be jogging these horses downhill in the vet box.
First horse on course, Karen Lundy and Prince Panache riding for the USA. Her dressage score is 60.2. And we're going to have Andy down there in the vet box to let us know what's going on.
So the chain of events that are going to start taking place here in a minute is we're going to see Karen's horse arrive here. And the horse will then be presented to the grand jury. The horse's temperature, pulse, and respiration will be taken. And a note will be taken of those vital statistics. The horse will also be allocated a timer. Now this person is going to be responsible for clocking your horse's time during this 10-minute period. It's your job to ensure to know who that timer is, as you'll want to be made aware of the time as it elapses. It's a good idea to have the person that's going to stand down here, and in fact here we have Karen now, so we're actually going to follow Karen through the process of the 10-minute box. And you can see Karen trotting the horse in to display the soundness of the horse. The horse still looking very fresh and sound. A visual inspection was made of the shoes as the horse came in. And now as we see the helpers placing the thermometer in, and the veterinarian, Dr. Barbara Forney, taking the horse's heart rate. Now you can see how rapidly everybody's moving around the horse, but they're still moving very calmly and efficiently, ensuring that not to excite the horse. A cooler has been placed on the horse to keep the rear end warm, and also a rain sheet over the top.
Well, we first competitor are now out on course.
We can see Paul loosening the nose band, and a head collar and lead rope has been placed on the horse.
Thanks, Andy. And Karen now down to fence four, the ditch and brush.
Well, the first three fences, they gave you time to get up on your feet. And now this is the first combination you ride. She left it out in two and one. That's a good sign. It's early in the course, but that's a good sign that the horse is really, you know, focused. That was your first question.
Is that a related distance, or is that
well,
strange distance?
There is a related distance there, but, you know, when you're jumping a ditch in a brush like that, you know, who knows? You know, who knows?
And, of course, that big line here to these two very big oxers.
Yes, and that I think is going to, you know, I would think would cause some, that's a directional problem, and I would think it would cause some problems in this weather later on. Because, again, you don't know how they're going to respond, whether you're going to do four strides or a direct three to this. And then after that, you come to that big vertical gate. And it's really raining now. So, I mean, going early might be to an advantage here, because at least you get some of this old sod and turf. So I think if I was riding, I'd rather go earlier and get it done before the course deteriorates.
So this is going to be a big question throughout the day as to how much stud you're going to need, how much you're going to have
exactly.
to put on feet. And there's a lot of big open gallops here.
Well, and that's good towards the end because they threw a lot at you early on. That fence that you just saw, her jump, they in fact, because of the weather, they put a takeoff rail in front of it. From this angle, it didn't look like a lot, but there was it was quite a big vertical with a drop behind it and a natural ditch in front. Here she's coming to, I know a lot of riders are worrying whether they're going to get one or two. She pushed for the one. You saw that mare was game. She really reached for it, but the principle was Karen stuck with her program. She really rode strong to it. That was a big effort, and I know a lot of people are watching to see what's going to happen there.
And down to this frog pond, which is just a kind of a vertical into a pond. But still very open and airy.
Well, and the saving grace behind it is, and you said the horse was a little cautious there, but the right kind of cautious, was that there was a takeoff rail in front of it, so that helped.
Okay, down to 16 through 19 now, called the Serpent. There's five jumping efforts in here.
Yeah, this is a really, this is, when we walked the course with Mark Phillips, as he said, this is a four-star question, and this is a three-star event. And she's, you know, this mare is, you know, the first two were, she was really working. Now she's, you know, she made it look easy for the way that fence was designed. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. It's going to ride tough all day long.
Yeah, those are like 10-meter turns left and right and twist and move and nice over this boat dock.
Yeah, I mean, really nice. And I'm surprised they didn't put an option going in. You know, you have to jump that log. All horses are going to look awkward over it.
And Bruce Davidson with Heyday now, riding for the USA, a score of 58.4 to start his day off.
When conditions are a little bit more friendlier and the weather's a bit warmer, all the equipment you see in the back of us would be laid out on the ground in clear view. Obviously, it's not practical to do that today because of the weather conditions, but you can see how the buckets have been placed at a distance from the tack trunks, and therefore the horse can be walked through. Now we're seeing a stud change being done.
Grant Snyderman going very well. The Pathfinder is over the Tidworth at 21.
And you notice how calm everybody is around this horse. And Debbie, they're just giving those studs an extra turn to ensure that nothing comes loose on the next phase, which is the cross country.
Sponsored by All States Driving Services. That's 24 and 25. 25 in the dog.
Grease now being applied. The grease compound that Bruce uses is a special type of water-soluble medicated cream. It's important to make sure that you don't touch anything else once you've applied this grease, as you don't want grease on the reins or the stirrups. Again, now you'll watch Debbie look around for a nice, clear, flat spot, and the horse will be jogged now for the veterinarians to ensure soundness to continue.
And continue we will, down to fence four, now on course, Bruce Davidson and Heyday.
Well, this is one of his upcoming horses. This is a really special horse. Bruce has high expectations for it, as we all do with, you know, horses coming along. But this horse we watched go at Essex in the spring, and this is going to be a really nice one. Now this, you see how he gave this horse time because of the footing.
Little slip there.
Yeah, it was a little slip. That's the way it's going to ride, but he opted to jump straight, whoa, then make the turn. And here he comes. He's taking a little bit of a longer route here because of the footing and this being in the woods. He decided to give a little, take a little bit of extra time here so that the horse didn't slip and make a mistake early in the game. And that's important with, you know, especially your green horses. You don't want them to take a hard knock early so that you can open up. And here he comes to one of the tougher complexes other than the Serpent.
It looks like the bounce for him going here now.
Yeah, yes, the way he's riding, definitely the bounce. He didn't want to take the opportunity for this green horse to make a mistake, obviously.
And it looks like he's giving this horse a lot of extra support up in front there.
Well, you know, due to the conditions and not knowing the horse, they're substantial size bounces. And there you can see now he lands and hits the throttle. He definitely trusts this horse's gallop to believe that he can make up some of the time that he lost going to the corners. I think because of the distance being, you know, stuck between a deathly long one or a really tight two, as brave as this horse is, he decided, you know, rather than, you know, Shannon's a little more seasoned. She can make a mistake.
Oh, and he's going fast enough to fool our cameraman here.
Yeah, really. And you can see with the rain, they're starting to land into that water ditch. But again, this horse is going to be really a nice one. He jumped that narrow section on that side, and away he goes.
And this is a six-year-old owned by Dr. Eleanor Jenny from Unionville, Pennsylvania.
Yeah, and it's unusual to see something, you know, 6 years old jumping around a course like this. And look how tight he was there.
Yeah.
He just tapped a little bit behind. That's going to be probably one of the best techniques over that jump, horse-wise, that you're going to see.
Peter Green riding for the USA now on Sandalwood. His dressage score is 61.0 and a little bit of time on steeplechase, but that's probably going to be the case today in this weather.
Well, as the course goes along, it's going to be tougher and tougher. Now, Peter's had this horse quite a while. You saw him make a big ride move there. He needed to. It's up to the horse to get you out of there, and that's quite a substantial ditch.
And this horse, very catty. Very. Boom.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Man, he left the leg there. Both of them just lost concentration there. Not quite enough zip when he left the hind leg. He needed to, at that moment then, to either real quick pull out and come back or give him a real quick kick and make him go. And, you know, I know Peter now is disappointed. This is early in the course. He's had this horse for a while.
Yeah, they've been together for quite a
yeah,
while.
Yeah, I mean, that was just a shock to both.
Okay, 20 penalties there for Peter. So.
Well, and I think that time is definitely, as it is in any three-star, time's going to be the factor. You can see him really running there. He's got to run the fast option now and try to take away some of that 20 with a fast round. You could conceivably, if you could make the time, still get away with 20 penalties.
And balancing for the fast way, it looks.
Ooh. Oh, man, oh, man, oh, man. Now, see, there he was riding as if he was going to do the two strides. I mean, he organized it and planned it. And it looked like the horse just powered in a little bit more than both of them suspected when the horse went to settle up for the two strides. He just slid.
And that unfortunate. But that didn't seem to affect that horse at all.
No, he came back and jumped at the corner. But, you know, this is just this goes along with the weather. This is a long afternoon for Peter. And, I mean, look, I mean, the horse there,
oh, yeah.
Brilliant. It is the first horse to jump out over the water. And look, the really
no
fast, that's the quickest way, you know, quickest horse we've seen thus far through there. It's, you know, it's...
Yeah, the sight of an experienced horse, he makes a mistake, he knows he can go on from there.
Yeah, look at him leave the stride out there. Great leap. Oh, and a little frog leap. I'll tell you.
Air green.
Oh, I'll tell you, man.
A little photographic insight there.
Oh, I'll tell you, this is the day Peter's going to want to go into that bar and just have a nice, warm, hot rum toddy.
And Bruce Mandeville riding for Canada now on Hitman.
And he's hitting the man.
All right, Bruce, up over that. Down to the Oxers now.
This is probably the biggest effort that Bruce has asked. Look at that horse smoke those double Oxers.
Absolutely.
That was beautifully done.
No problem. These guys have been together for a while now, and I believe this is their first CCI.
Yeah, this is a big effort for both of these, but you can see that it looks like the horse and the rod are up for the task. Notice that Bruce is carrying a weight pad. They all have to be at least 165 pounds with equipment, and Bruce is a smaller guy, and he doesn't weigh 165 without having to carry some lead.
To the bounce.
To the bounce. And I think again, now this is going to be interesting. He didn't get the turn. This could be a technical here. I'm not sure.
Okay.
We'll have to see how they judge it, but that's a shame. Again, I think he's a little worried because this horse is, it's his first big CCI. The horse is jumping great, and he figured, well, let's get him around clean. And I mean, because he knows he's got the big serpents coming up, which is what he's coming to now, which is a tough effort on a horse. Oh, he's a little steering. Yeah. Now just relax and let it happen now.
A little bit of a big effort over that one.
Yep. And of course, you know, he's at the ends of the range. You get a little disoriented sometimes in there. That's a lot of efforts for that late in the course.
The horse still looking good, though.
Yeah, and this is getting towards the end of the course. This is past the three-quarter mark. And, now see there? That's just a green mistake. That's why I think there should be an option. This horse should not be punished. It was worth taking a shot, but there should be an easier way now because the horse didn't know where to leave the ground. He came up. That log is just a little bit too small. They need a big log to fill in some of that air. And see, now the horse has lost a little bit of confidence. And this is, I mean, it was smart for Bruce to do just what he did, but I think that fence should have an option. It's a shame for him to have a beautiful round to that point and not have a way of getting home.
Yeah, this has been a problem for the past year or so, and of course it was 2 years ago they did have the option there. Phyllis Dawson in Byway now with a 61.2 from dressage and 13.6 time penalties on the steeplechase.
So the rain has really taken effect, but look, she's going the fast way. Now that horse added the stride there, nice four. She knows this. She took this horse, if I'm not mistaken, over to Burley. So this horse has been around the block a little bit.
And, of course, Phyllis, a very experienced rider, riding for the 1988 Seoul Olympic team.
And, again, seeing Bruce is one of her, you know, she works under Bruce. He's her mentor, and she has opted to go the same way he did here, the longer way. It's just a little less risk.
Looks like it might be a little effort for this horse to gallop around this course with this mud.
Well, it's going to be an effort for all of them, I'll tell you, as deep as it is. They're all going to hit, and because that's jumping into space, they're all going to leave their hind ends at that first element.
And a nice left turn there
for
that big horse.
And you can see if you stay at the ends of your reins. Now, there was her fault. If she'd have just stayed in position and held the steadiness of the rein, the horse would have gone. But she suddenly changed her balance, which broke his concentration, and she was already at the ends of her reins. And that was a costly mistake for her. That's 20 big
just
ones.
Nowhere to go.
Yep. Now she's got to get into the horse a little bit because it's getting late in the course, and this water complex is starting to cause problem and deteriorate. There you go. See, there's mileage. The horse adds mileage. But notice how she just stayed there with her body that time.
Yeah.
And so the horse was able to figure out how to get out.
And Philip Dutton in True Blue Girdwood now riding for Australia, and he is clean up until this point, 59.4 in the dressage.
Now, I saw this horse run at Kentucky, and this boy just really lays the hammer down and lets this thing ramble. And quite an athlete, so it'll be fun to watch him. You know, the Australians have a tendency to that gun-ho spirit, as you just saw there.
Pushing him over that second.
Exactly. He's not fazed by the weather at all. Look at him going down the pike right here. But this is going to be an exciting round to watch. This guy is like, hey, just another day at the office.
And Girdwood thinks so, too.
Yep. I mean, this is a good combination. You can tell they both enjoy what they're doing. And it's interesting how he has it braided, look right to the corners.
Ooh.
And a long one there. But we all, you know, when we walked it, it's a long distance. But he, you know, that's cross country.
Ooh.
Oh, and a little bit of demonstration in the forward seat there.
Oh, nice. They had that tree there for him.
Yep, the tree helped him. But look at this. Look, Mom, no stirrups. And right over. And that's what you got to do. Don't lose your concentration. You'll find your pedal eventually.
Oh, nice ride by Philip. Hang in there, Philip.
Now, he'll get back in attack here. He's still got a lot of horse left here. Look at this. See that horse kick out?
Yeah, he's a clever little guy.
I'll tell you, this is a combination to reckon with.
Is there a fence that you would particularly say he was a star at? I was really pleased with him at the corners because there's a long distance in there, and that's not something he's not a great big striding horse, you know. He tends to like to shorten a bit more, and that was a really long distance and it was in the wet, and he did do the one stride in there, and there's a lot of bigger horses that put two in there, and so I was quite really pleased with that.
Well, it sounds like he was really game then.
Yeah, he is game, and he trusts me, and he's really finished off the year well.
And so our current standings, Philip Dutton and True Blue Girdwood are in the lead. Karen Lundy and Prince Panache right behind him with an 87.4. Bruce Davidson and Heyday, the six-year-old, with an 87.6. Phyllis Dawson and Byway, Peter Green and Sandalwood, and Bruce Mandeville with an unfortunate withdrawal. And back on course with From France, Philippe Mule and Tempe de Vire, which I took Spanish in high school, so sorry, my French isn't very good. He goes out with a 63.8.
Well, I'm all American too, so that's beyond my comprehension.
Nice chestnut horse.
Right, a good chestnut horse that just jumped those oxes quite well. I'm sure that, you know, with Philip Dutton putting the pressure on him, he had a really good round and it was relatively fast for the conditions. And he was a little bit long there. He's got to make this turn back. See, this turn is becoming, in this rain, very difficult because the reins get slippery.
Yeah, and a good demonstration of direct rain there by Philippe.
Correct. And here he is for the second bounce. See, once they're over the first one, the horses, you know, understand the exercise.
And down to the serpent here. Let's see how he handles this thing.
Now there he was really slick there. This Ooh. Turn is getting to be very difficult. Now there he took one too many snags with the direct rein, and that caused that horse to rub that behind.
Yeah.
It's better to use an opening rein if you can get away with it. Then you don't lose the concentration of your horse.
It looks like that's Philippe's technique.
And this horse is quite clever. This is a nice horse. He looks very kind. He's got a good expression. He's galloping right along.
Any questioning that one?
Well, there he did, you know, but when we walk it, it's getting towards the end of the course. They need a little more zip out of the turn, so the horse has, see, once they stop like that and they're behind your leg, it's hard to get them to go. You have that one moment where you got to get them what we call angry in the bridle and really come up the hill so the horse has an opportunity to give it a shot. You know, and he just came too casual through the turn, and it cost him again. I don't think this fence should cost him that price.
Yeah.
But no, now notice what he's doing. Very smart move. He knew he was eliminated, but let the horse know he didn't totally win. Get his feet wet so he'll understand and come back again.
And an unfortunate elimination all the way from France for Philippe. Peter Gray now in North End from Bermuda.
Yeah, and Peter's been in England for quite a while. He gets some nice horses to ride. He's representing Bermuda. He's a good rider. He competes a lot in the United States. This should be a good round to watch.
Yeah, well-known international rider with lots of experience.
Whoop, now that was interesting. That horse jumped really good. Now he's got quite an angle to deal with. He dealt with it, but I think the way that horse jumped that first one, he could have probably just made that turn and taken the shot at the three or the four.
Well, straight down the hill here.
Yeah, I think he's starting to realize that this horse is a quite attractive horse and looks like it's got a lot of jump.
Yeah. And over to the serpent for Peter.
Now, it was very handy there.
A little slip there, but a good turn.
Yeah, I mean, good turn. And that's the key, is you got to look early in this weather. And you can see it's hard for everybody to notice that there are drops after those. And it's takes quite a toll on the horse and rider. That's why it's hard for them to keep the reins. Now he's trying to get him. You can see a little check there. And then he comes forward, but not enough. Again, it was checking without backing up with the leg. Now there he tries 10 cc's of impulsion. You have about one more shot now, the way this fence is designed. And look, the horse's ears are pricked. He just doesn't understand it. That's a shame.
That's part of the problem here with this fence, is that this is an exercise that a lot of these horses have not seen.
Well, exactly. And it's almost like too small of a log sitting too far up. They either need to lower the log or put a fatter log there to give the horse the opportunity. This is a very nice horse. And look,
oh,
say,
man.
I mean, he hooked a leg. This is quite an athlete. But you hate a green horse to get punished due to the course design.
And the horse goes for Peter. And now Stephen Bradley on a catch ride, sail on Madawaska for the USA.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, I caught rode a lot of horses, and I mean, it's a basic principle when you catch ride. Point them forward, take a deep seat, and keep kicking.
And Stephen also taking this trip with a broken ankle.
Well, I hope he didn't do that on a catch ride, because that tended to break your confidence a little bit. Now there, that you know, the horse wasn't focused. He couldn't get the turn on the horse. He's a bit of a rangy build horse.
Yeah.
And with the footing deteriorating like that, I think you have to choose a little more of a direct line if you can.
And of course, he doesn't know this guy.
No, he doesn't. And this horse just didn't focus on it. Stephen being one of Bruce's proteges, he's opted to take a little slower route there, but then he made a turn. That was interesting. That's the first, and I'll bet you it'll be the only one we see take that option.
Yeah, that was interesting. He seems to be taking a nice slow pace around here, too.
Well, you know, again, if you're catch riding, he hooked a leg there, and he's on the front
almost
of the saddle.
Almost.
Nope, he isn't going to save that one.
And Stephen back in the saddle, and he caught 10 penalties for that now.
Oh, man.
Didn't crossing it. And the footing's so bad, our cameraman's losing it as well.
I'll tell you. Now, did he fall off in the penalty zone? That's the question. Well, I don't think it's going to matter.
They're going to give him 10 on that one, so that must be a crossing your line.
He must have got out of the penalty zone then. This is a situation where this horse really hit that fence hard. When you hit a fence that's fixed like that, their hind ends go higher than their front. Now, this horse is game. I'll tell you, if Stephen had this horse a little longer and rode him a couple of times, he would have got around clean.
Okay, Gary Roque now with Casemate riding for Canada. He's got a 66.8 in the dressage, and again, time on steeplechase.
We see all different sizes and shape. This is a really good athletic Appaloosa.
Very athletic. Well, he flew over that one.
Yeah, this is quite a big horse for an Appaloosa, size-wise. And I don't know, that's showing you the athletic ability of this horse. I don't think I'd be trotting down there. That's the hardest thing to teach a rider. When the footing starts to deteriorate, you have to ride with a little more weight in the rein, but a little stronger pace. So if they do slip, the horse can grab ground somewhere.
Yeah, Gary, having been with this horse for quite a hello.
Whoops.
He's coming to visit the camera.
And I'd say we're doing a little weed whacking or tree whacking here.
With his head.
And that's just, you know, in these kind of conditions, you know, reins are slipping, everything's giving up, you know, giving away underneath you. It's just miserable out there. But this is taking way too much time here.
It looks like there is a problem with the reins here.
That's when you got to be like John Wayne and just put those reins in your teeth and kick, Pilgrim, kick.
You need a shotgun to clear the course as well.
Really, I'll tell you.
That way he wouldn't have to use his head to do the trim.
I'll tell you, this horse has not backed off really of anything. He's just loping around. Now, see, to me, this looks like a little bit under-riding.
Yeah. It looks like Gary might be a little worn out here.
Yeah. I mean, this horse is a puller, and I think he's just tired Gary out a little bit.
Okay, and he's not picking up any penalties for that little detour at the Serpent, but he's got 20 here now for this stop down here.
Well, now you got to bite the bullet, and you've got to get him really angry in the bridle and take your shot, or you're going to be hacking home. Look at this. Now, that was just, you know, that 20 right there was Gary, not the horse.
And here's a quick word from Gary about what happened.
What was the snag?
I had a pair of gloves, a brand new pair of gloves, and they were supposed to be sticky, but with all the wet and the reins, the reins just kept sliding through my hands. So he's not real good at turning left anyway. And with the rain sliding through my hand, there was no way I was going to make that left-hand turn. So.
Oh, better luck next time, Gary. Next on course, Jill Henneberg and Nirvana 2 from the United States. This is one of our young riders coming out here now.
Yes, this is one of our up-and-coming young riders. She's had a very good season. A little cheap with the reins there, but this horse has a lot of jump off the ground.
Yeah, this is a little horse, too.
Yep, and you'll see her clipping right along. You know, the young and the brave.
Well, it looks like she's setting up for the corner here now.
Well, this will be interesting to see. She usually tries to run all the direct routes. The pace looks a little slow, so she must be trying to ride the two strides.
Yes. Effort.
And the mare jumped it great. So she there again, this is a partnership, and she knew that she could do the quiet too. So she really trusts this one, obviously, to to be able to do that. And that was one of the best turns we've seen. It's a shame she got a little bit handsy there at that time. But after that, she actually eased off and gave her quite a good ride. She's having the trip of her life, I'd say.
And of course, this is her first CCI 3-star.
Now, see that little snap of the stick? 10 cc's of impulsion, let her know, hey, let's go. And then, boom, right up over.
Real tidy there.
Yep,
yeah.
And the mare's ears were up, used her head and neck. I'll tell you, she keeps riding like this. This will be one to be pushing us older guys.
And she's going to push a couple older guys right here as she moves into fourth place with a 147.8. A lot of time for her. Philip Dutton still maintaining the lead. Karen Lundy still in second. Bruce Davidson maintaining third. Phyllis Dawson is now in fifth. And Peter Gray brings up the end with the sixth place.
It's at this point that the vet box is divided. Once the horse is completed on cross country, they'll come through this entrance at the far end of this area where they'll be examined by the veterinarians. This will be the final inspection of the day for that horse. It's then the groom's job to take care of the horse, get him cooled down as quickly as possible. At the same time, remember, this is a cold day. You want to be putting warm coolers on the horse and a rain sheet and keep him as dry as possible. Toughest jobs in the vet box, I always feel, is carried out by the veterinarians. They're either made out to be the villains or the heroes. And with us right now is Dr. Ken Allen from Arizona, an FEI official, and also on the grand jury for the veterinarians at this event. Ken, I'd like to ask you, first of all, how you feel the event's going so far.
I think it's been going real well so far. We've obviously had a very cool day, and so that has basically reduced the amount of any sort of heat problems that we would see. Footing seems to be holding up. The horses are getting around well. So far, I'm pretty pleased with the way things are going. We check the vitals on the horses as they come in. 6 minutes later, before they're ready to leave out on the cross-country course, and then, of course, when they come back in, we're checking them again at 10-minute intervals to make sure they're ready to release, make sure nothing has happened that would require any sort of medical attention, and then we get them home.
And Kent Allen, one of our more experienced vets who does travel the 3-day circuit and watches a lot of these horses go. Edie Tarve is now with Socrates, a very experienced team from Canada.
This horse and rider combination have been over to Europe and they've been around a lot of courses, so we should see sort of a smoker round here. You can see that she tends to ride pretty much wide open when she can.
Yeah, and he is a wide open horse too.
Yeah, I think it was really important what Ken Allen said. What we're starting to finally realize, we're getting a good rapport with the veterinarians, and we know that they're on our benefit and our horses, they're for our benefit and our horses' benefit, and they're really trying to help us out. Well, what do you think, Luann? One or two here heading to the corners?
The bounce.
That surprises me. You know, the way she was running, jumping, I thought she would have taken the shot to run right to the corner to corner.
You think maybe that might have been useful for her to slow him down?
Well, it could have been that, or I believe it was last year or even this year that she had some trouble at a corner over in York. And that could have been it. Maybe she's, you know, just regrouping.
A little effort to get him turned there.
Yep, and then see what happens is because of this turn and the landing, everybody's to the ends of the reins, and it's just hard to keep this smooth.
Oh, yeah.
You know, hard to keep it smooth, but she's having a heck of a trip.
It'd be hard to ride a line like that in the flat, let alone doing all those up and down and jumps.
Well, yeah, let's put it this way. Your weight's not going to be in your heels and crest releasing it through that exercise. And there's the showing of the mileage and the partnership through mileage.
And she's going to give a little hint for the mileage for our first-timers out here.
Well, I would say it's a pretty good challenge for them. And, they got to go out there and really ride and not take anything for granted, not sit and wait for the horse to do it. Even my horse, he's pretty experienced, and I've had lots of experience, but, you know, I rode my bum off all the way around.
Good for you, Edie. Marcia Kulak in Galleria now, and 62.0, and just a few points on steeplechase for her.
Hey, 0.8 steeplechase, that's only 1 second over. So, I mean...
Yeah, these conditions.
Right, under these conditions, obviously, this girl's going to want to ride her bum off.
And Galleria, getting to be an experienced mare with Marcia. She's had this horse for a while, but I don't know if this is the first CCI 3-star. I believe it is.
Well, there you can see a little bit of slipping on the landing there. Now, she'll feel it out to see whether she's going to, you know, how the footing's holding, whether she can take the shot to run the corners or do the bounce the safer route.
Looks good to the corners.
She's setting up.
Ooh.
Oh, what a clever horse right there. She jumped in, took the shot, the kick for the one, and that mare, I mean, that shows your homework. You know, that's part of cross country. She said, hey, Mom, you got to go. Look at this. No stirrups. Another one losing their pedals. Got it caught back. That's that equitation mileage working with that jumper guy, Tim Grubb, who's really good. She's been working for him. And obviously some of that's rubbed off. She got her pedal back real quick. The mare real quick figured it out. Look, I'm stall there.
Thought about that one, yeah.
Yep. But again, that's mileage. See, that horse didn't understand the exercise.
Okay, next on course, Jackie Page from Canada riding Shawman, a 73.2 on the dressage and a little bit of time on steeplechase.
Things have changed with you, though. You've done a lot as far as in the last year, as far as development with your horse and yourself.
Yep, yeah, I've really been trying to develop my horse and myself as much as possible. Okay. And I think that it's working, you know. I mean, I really do.
Yeah. Well, congratulations, and... I'm looking forward to seeing you soon. Hope you grow more.
Thank you. I'm hoping I'm growing as well.
Okay.
Well, she can't grow any more than what we've seen. She's going to have black eyes after this cross-country course, that's for sure. It's great to have a sense of humor on a critical day like this, and that's the Canadian spirit and Jackie's spirit. And we were just all having a little bit of fun there, and let's hope so far she's got a great round going. Let's hope she keeps growing out there.
She's going just fine.
Now, that's a smart move, I think, right now for this horse as its first really big year of competition and its first, big test.
Yeah.
And the weather's bad. And so I think this was the right decision.
Yeah, I believe she knows this horse quite well.
Yeah, this is a really nice horse. Her husband actually started the horse out.
Yeah.
And now she's taking it over. This will be the test for him. He was real clever there. Whoop, and see her real quick grab with both hands and then talk to him.
Yeah.
But notice she's not grabbing direct rein now. She's just sort of letting her hips go and make the turn. Look at that. You see, that's what I'm talking about. Let the horse concentrate on his job. There's no better master of their legs than the horse. Look at this, coming to the water.
She knows.
Good,
whoa.
Positive ride. See, take the shot.
Whoa,
yeah,
no reins.
Yeah, look, Mom, no hands. This is cross-country riding.
Jackie's got it down.
All right, I like it.
And all the way from the Netherlands, Eddie Stibbe in Parkview.
This is stiffer than Buccolo. Buccolo is the last big one in Europe on the continent. All the main events like Burley and the Championships have been, so they use them for the sort of the up and coming horses or the second swing horses to qualify. Buccolo is normally not hilly. This is very hilly, which makes it a lot stiffer. I mean, the size of the fence might be about the same, but because they're always on the slope, downhill or uphill, it makes it more difficult.
Right.
And of course, the slippery going will make it more difficult.
And he's down now to fence four, the ditch and brush.
Well, you can see all the footing's really starting to chew up there, but he came a positive ride, but there he jumped a little bit ahead. The horse was real clever to pat the ground. But you've got to ride, like Edie was saying earlier, you got to ride aggressive, and there was a bit of a gamble. That was a bit of a gamble there.
This can't be building his confidence.
No, this is not building the confidence. He needs to give a kick there. Whoops. Things are, you know, now he's got to, if you walk the course on these type of complexes, there's other options, and he's got a real quick run through his mind. You know, where's the other option? What can I do to get it? Like he said, everything's uphill or downhill. Now see, and he really isn't sure where he's going now. And so he's going to call it a day because he knows he's out of the hunt right now with 60.
And out of the four horses that they brought over, he and his wife Mandy, unfortunately none of them made it around.
That's really a shame to come, you know, that distance. And that's not the way the Americans, you know, I mean, we didn't plan on that. We want to be very hospitable because we like them to come back and compete again, and there'll be another competition.
And now Karen Lundy O'Connor. With Shannon, the horse that's in second place right now with 48.2, and she's clean A through C.
Yeah, well, she's going to put the pressure on her new husband, even though she demonstrated the forward seat there. She's going to definitely put pressure on her husband, you know, because she doesn't want to do the laundry.
No.
Now, look at this. See, now see, she kept it tidy, kept it neat, and just stayed patient. That was a very good ride there. Sometimes mistakes early in the course sharpen you up, and you notice she isn't jumping ahead here now. You know, that one little mistake was what she needed as a wake-up call to say, hey, you know, you're back out on the course here. You better hold your shoulders and wait a little bit.
And having toured this horse around Europe now, she's gotten to know this mare pretty well.
Well, yeah. Mm. Ooh, now, she got to know her pretty well, but, you know, in the rain there, the mare did drop a leg there, but, hey, we've been there. That doesn't mean it goes with the horse. It just means it went with that moment.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, that is getting a little chewed up around there, it looks like.
And now this, but see, then she came back and jumped it fine. And notice how that's what she learned from being over in England. They're stationed in England, land and go away from your jump. And that's why they're so fast over there. As soon as they land, they're gone. Good tidy turn there.
Lovely.
Yep, really nice. See, quick adjustment, slip the rein, look, keep pressing, and then gone.
Right, she's got a good one going.
Yep, she does. I tell you, she's going to put the pressure on her new husband. Good use of quick use of the stick there. Did you see that?
Yeah, that was great. Unfortunately, though, it wasn't going to be Karen's day, as she's going to have a stop at the bank up here, and she's going to tell us about it.
I overcorrected her, and so when she jumped up on the bank, she jumped up very, very well. She ran out right. Safety over 10. What are you going to do?
A little brokenhearted?
Well, I'm not disappointed with the round. I mean, she had a very, very good round, I thought, and jumped very, very well. Disappointed with the end of the day scores? Yeah, very. Anyway.
My condolences.
No, that's quite all right. It's another day.
But that round still slides her into sixth place with Shannon, as she maintains third place and sixth place. Philip Dutton still maintaining the lead. Edie Tarves with her brilliant round, moving her into second place. Bruce Davidson now moves into fourth, and Marcia Kulak moves into fifth place. But the weather getting worse, the action gets a little hotter. Our leaders are yet to come on the cross country here at the Fairhill International 3-day, 3-star event. And next on course, Bruce Davidson and Regent Lyon, 52.2, and he's got just a little bit of time on Steeplechase 2, 1 second over.
Well, you know, Bruce has usually got a pretty good clock in his head, so he'll get right to it here. The horse had his ears pinned there and struggled a little bit through there. So now Bruce will, you know, take a reading after this to decide whether he wants to you know, open up and go a little more speed or coast in between. It's really coming down now.
Yeah, these conditions are terrible, yeah, for humans at least.
Well, yeah, and I mean, it's deteriorating pretty quick, the footing. See, he stayed in balance there. There the horse is starting to get back in rhythm. Sometimes with this cold, damp weather, it takes 7 or 8 jumps for the horses to really get back in the flow.
And it is unfortunate we can't have more spectators out here. This weather is truly awful.
Well, that's, yeah, it is. And, you know, most of the spectators are in the warm tent somewhere. Now, from him being around once, you can see that he's staying pretty much with the same plan that he had on the other green horse. He knows through mileage and being in this country that with this course at this level, 2 clean rounds with time are still going to put you in the top 10. And that's what he's trying to do here is, let's get around and no major faults.
A little bit of a wide turn there, but still keeping the rhythm going.
Right, wide turn there, and a little bit, he went to the stick a little bit there because he knew he was behind the rhythm, and then he stayed patient at the last one and then go on away. He knows now that the water is the biggest question left now with this horse, so it'll be interesting to see. See, there's the partnership. He knew he could trust him. A little tap on the shoulder there to get him focused to coming out. He's got a pretty good trip going.
And Didier Sigaret and Coeur de Rocker from France taking this out with a clean A through C and a 51.2, so he's got a good shot at this one, too.
Well, and look at him. I mean, he's attacking this course.
Oh, this horse fires, huh?
Yep, he's attacking this course. You know, he didn't come all this mileage to just to hunt around. this guy wants a major piece of the action here. They're giving some prize money, and he wants some of it, obviously. He's riding really at it, which is good to see because, I mean, this is his last chance to get this horse qualified for the world, and he's edging it. Look at him. I mean, he knows this horse, obviously, really well.
He looks determined to do it, yeah.
Yep, and there, now that's interesting. He didn't go for the corners. I would have thought he would have went for the corners, but maybe he thought it didn't, with the footing deteriorating, maybe he decided with that long of a distance, it didn't warrant the gamble, which I bet you if you talked to him in the beginning before it rained, he would have done the corners. Now, he had the discipline as a mature athlete to take a little slower route. A little bit behind, which you have to be all the way through. And that was really quick there at the end. Once he made the turn, man, he kept his sights going forward.
And this horse really using his legs and using his...
Took a little hard hit there. See, that's why I don't like those kind of fences there. Sometimes when horses are even brave, they take a little bit of a bump there.
And now, our leader, David O'Connor and Wilton Fair, the most experienced team out here, 45.8.
Well, he's jumped around Badminton, Burley. I mean, this should be like wearing your favorite pair of shoes, I would think. You know, I mean, this combination right here should know each other inside and out. So, I mean, it doesn't matter whether it's raining, sleeting, or hailing. Once you're out there running, if you had to run on a horse, it certainly would be one that you'd want to be a combination with like this.
And he is definitely running in the worst part of the day. This has really become awful.
Oh, yeah, and look at that. He can float the reins there, let the horse gallop on, readjust. You know, hey, it's just,
Okay, does he know him well enough for the corner here?
Well, I would think, you know, hey, if you're going to go, let's go in a blaze of glory. Let's sit up for the corner and get it, you know? You know this horse. Look at this. See, let him pat the ground, do the two strides, kick you out. Look, see, and he knows it. He said, this is the way we want to go out, smoking.
No problem.
No problem over that. That little turn. Now, look, he'll get to the ends of the reins. Now, the only reason he smacked him with a stick there was to make him kick out off of that drop so he didn't land so deep in the water. David knows now that he's putting in a really good trip. He's got the water in that one bank complex that his wife had trouble with left, standing in his way of one of his best trips cross country. Look at that. See that horse slide? A green horse wouldn't know how to deal with that.
Yeah.
The older horse just said, okay, this is just cross country. This is just the day at the office. I'll keep sliding until I can find some ground to get over. And that's maturity.
Dang, it's real good weather.
Let's get a little story about his real heart and soul.
Well, this horse never says never. He's an amazing horse in that three of his major successes have been all in conditions like this. He had the fastest ride today. He had one of the fastest rides in Kentucky when he won it in 1990. In Badminton in 1992, was it? 1992, the year of the Olympics. In very, very adverse conditions over a four-star course, one of the biggest courses I've ever rode. He was incredible. All excellent rides that I've had on him. And so he's a horse that just absolutely never says never. He just keeps going. He's such a trier. And his one thing, he's a horse that just wants to get the job done and completely thoroughly enjoys his job. It's hard retiring him in some ways because, you know, when they're running like this, but I'm very proud of the fact that I can retire him at the top of his form. Completely sound, loving every minute of it. I'll be lucky to ever do that again in my life.
And so with that round, David O'Connor maintains the lead with the Irish-bred Wilton Fair 65.2 penalties. Didier Cigaret from France moves into second place with a 70.0. Philip Dutton now in third place, maintaining his 72.6. Bruce Davidson and Regent Lion in fourth. Edie Tarvez moves into fifth place. And those are our standings as we move into day three, the Stadium Jumper.
Well, due to the rain and the slipperiness caused by the rain here at Fairhill International, I'm sure there are a couple little problems, a little slip-ups here and there. What was the first thing that had to be addressed from your point of view with the horses?
Well, in terms of the conditions of the horses, and the horses will slip, what you basically have is a situation where when a horse slips, it'll bring one of the limbs, one of the legs beyond a safe range of motion. And that's when you get strain-type muscle injuries. So basically, we did see quite a few horses where with an overreach or a slip, the hind end slips under going up to the jump, we might have a gluteal or a hamstring tear, or just a hamstring strain even. You know, so basically we saw some horses that were a little sore in the hamstrings and the gluteals, whatever. There's often situations where the problems that these horses get after cross country are primarily muscle problems, so they're not specifically veterinary problems or structural problems. So what we can do is address them with a specific muscular therapy, which is massage.
Thank you, Robert Altman, for that quick comment. Robert is, of course, the universe's premier equine sports therapist. Day three saw Edie Tarves, who was standing in fifth place with an 84.2, drop a rail and have a little bit of time here, and so she finishes with a 90.2, which unfortunately drops her out of fifth place, makes a little room for the next two ladies to come on in, who were Karen Lendy, riding the new horse for her, Prince Panache. She finishes with a little bit of time on stadium with an 88.9, and right ahead of her was Marsha Kulak with Galleria. And Marsha had a lovely clean round on stadium, and she finishes with an 88.8, putting her into fifth place.
Well, this mare was really a careful jumper, as we noticed yesterday on cross country. So Marsha was able to really press her to the jumps, and that's why she was able to get the clean round.
And Bruce Davidson, with a two-day total of 76.6, he drops a rail in stadium and has a little bit of time, and he finishes with an 82.1. And of course, in third place was Philip Dutton from Australia. He had a 72.6 after 2 days, and unfortunately, Philip dropped a rail here as well, but that held him in third place. A little bit of time, 78.85.
Well, after that brilliant cross-country round, I'm glad to see him at least hang in there till third. You'd hate to see him drop any lower.
And all the way from France, Didier Cigaret and Cours du Rocker with a two-day total of 70.0. He finishes with just a little bit of time on stadium, but that gave David room, just enough room to have a rail if he needed to have it. So he finishes with a 70.75, guaranteed second place.
Well, the pressure's really laying on David. You know, what a way to end a horse's event career, winning a major three-star event in North America, no less, competing against Europeans and other fellow Americans. So, you know, we got to just hold our breath and hope that the old man's up to the test, you know?
After the way he went around the day before, it was truly remarkable to watch a 16-year-old horse so catty and so ready to go.
Well, you know, it's like any other sport. If you do the homework and condition these horses and train them and develop their bodies, they can last for quite a long time. And it's nice to see, you know, a horse enjoy his job. And, you know, this horse truly does.
Everything looks like it's no effort whatsoever for him.
And you can see his ears are up. Now, he's not as quite a classic jumper as most. You see him stick his landing gear out a little early.
Mm-hmm.
He'll tend to do that at the wider oxers. That's why David gave that little tap with the stick. And but they know each other so well that both of them have learned how to deal with that one flaw in his jumping style. There, he was quite good there. I know what's going through David's mind right now is this horse is really jumping well in this bad weather. If I can just keep my composure here. Now the horse jumped to the right there and actually jumped the high side of that Swedish Oxer. So for running in the mud and having one of the fastest times, this horse has got a lot of spring and suppleness left. And what a nice way for a horse to, you know, go out of his career at the top of his game, you know.
David's, even if the horse knocked a few rails here, now David's got to be ecstatic.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, but now you got to stay patient. The suspense is building. That's a pretty tough line. Ooh. See a little bit of rattle there. Oh, and he looks back. That's a cardinal sin, but it's hard for us not to do. You're never supposed to look back. But he had to, you know. He's still in the hunt. He wants to be able to have that great victory gallop.
Okay, one more fence.
And he got that plank fences on flat cups. Saw a distance there.
That's it.
Yep, there it is. He's got to be happy with that.
All right, and your winner, the 1993 Fairhill 3-star CCI, David O'Connor and Wilton Ferrer. What a way to go. International 3-star.